Hi, my name is John Liu, and I'm the publisher and editor-in-chief of Beyond the Breakwater and OceansGiftJournal.com. In this video segment, I'm going to be changing my trailer, which has a removable tongue, over to an arrangement where the tongue swings away and folds back against the frame. When I bought the trailer in 2000, it had the removable tongue so I could get it inside my garage. I have a standard 19.5-foot long garage. The hull is 17.5-foot, and then with the motor and the rest of the trailer parts hanging off, I basically only have about 2 or 3 inches of clearance from the front of the trailer receptacle to the inside of the garage door. The main problem with this kind of setup, though, is that the tongue itself weighs about 45 pounds, and it's quite a bit of weight to lug around at 4 in the morning. And over time, I think I'm going to get tired of doing this. I mean, I've been doing it for 5 years, and now that I'm getting a little bit older, you know, it's a little bit harder on the back. I'm getting lazy. The swing away tongue will basically allow me to swing the tongue in, get the clearance I need, and without having to lug the 45 pounds around. It'll also set me up so that if I want to change over from the current electric brake setup to a hydraulic brake setup, a little easier, because in the current setup, I can't have a hydraulic system without some sort of like stainless steel quick disconnect for the brake lines. That's why I use electric brakes on my trailer. But with the swing away tongue, since the tongue never comes away, I could in fact use a hydraulic system with flexible hydraulic lines instead of the electric brakes that I currently have now, which are okay, but they don't get a lot of stopping power. But that's another project. So anyway, as part of this video clip, I'm going to be showing you the process of removing the tongue. It turns out that Pacific Trailer, which made my trailer, sells all the components I need to be able to convert to a swing away tongue, right off the shelf. Everything's pre-drilled, so I don't even have to get out the Craftsman hand drill and get ready to bore some holes through steel, which is a lot of work. All the parts are pre-drilled. With a little luck, this should just be a straight bolt-off, bolt-on kind of installation. But as anybody who has worked around boats knows, that hardly ever happens, especially with something that's been in salt water for a while. I can see right now, for example, that I have some corrosion on some of the bolts and things like that, so it could be tough to take this thing apart. But we'll see. It's Saturday morning, and with a little luck, I'll be done by Saturday afternoon. Hopefully the same week, but we'll see. All right? So let me show you the removable trailer tongue assembly as it stands right now. Up here in the front, you can see the female part of the removable tongue assembly. This little hole right here is normally filled by this shear pin, which goes through and holds the tongue in place. If we look in the back, we can see that the tongue assembly, the outer tongue assembly, is actually held in place by this single bolt right here. So theoretically, all I should have to do, everything works well, is remove the winch stand right here, which is held on with 2 U-bolts, and then take out that bolt in the back, and then the whole assembly should slide right out through here. Of course, anybody that's used had bolts in salt water know that there's always some problem, and I can already tell that there's probably going to be an issue with taking off the winch stand. Because if we come under here and look, you can see that the U-bolts holding the winch stand to the bottom of the trailer are pretty heavily corroded. So I'm going to try and hit those with some corrosion X or something to help break the corrosion on the bolts, and hopefully those will come right off. But you know, I'm anticipating a hard time of it. So we'll see how that works. But that should be the biggest roadblock to getting that whole assembly out. So this is actually the removable part of the tongue. You can see pretty substantial piece of metal. The tongue in front of the first pin is actually about 42 inches long. It's got standard 2-inch ball coupler, safety chains, and then the controller unit and the backup battery for my electric braking system. This is a Carlisle electric brake. I think they call it the ElectroStar. And that's worked out okay on the boat. Stopping power is not quite what I would have liked. But it's adequate. I mean, the main purpose for brakes in a trailer this size is to slow it down should it actually get detached from the vehicle. But as far as additional stopping power goes on the trailer, it's sort of minimal. But that's okay. Like I said, it's mainly there for safety purposes. Now the problem, of course, is that the battery and all that stuff basically adds a lot of weight to the tongue. So this whole assembly right now, I'm guessing, weighs about 45 pounds. And like I said, early in the morning, it's a pain in the rear end to be able to put it in and take it out and get it adjusted. So with the swing away tongue, I shouldn't have that problem. Like I mentioned before, the other pieces that go in have already been pre-drilled and cut to the right length by Pacific Trailer. So we should have, it should be just a bolt-in installation. In fact, let me go over here and I'll show you the pieces. Okay, so this is the forward part of the tongue. Up front here, you can see it's already been drilled for the ball coupler, and I believe this might be for the safety chain. And then here in the back, you can see they've already drilled the four holes that are necessary for the swing away tongue coupler. And the same thing goes for this piece in the back. This is the part that'll go into the frame. You can see the four holes here. And then the holes that are necessary to hold it in place in the frame. So there's the front hole and the back hole. Okay, so I've hit the ends of the U-bolt with some Bow Shield, which is a spray lubricant kind of thing, the anti-corrosion spray, which hopefully will block or help loosen up some of the corrosion. Let it sit for about 3 or 4 minutes, and I'm about to give it a whack. I've got a 3/4 inch socket at the end of my 1/2 inch drive, and let's see what happens. Oh, there we go. Okay, so that's good. So it looks like that one was pretty easy. That's a good sign. Normally these things are take a lot more leverage. I don't have a breaker bar handy, but I've got a my torque wrench, which has got a about an 18 inch handle, so I'll use that if I have to. Oh, this one's coming off much easier. Okay, good job. Okay, that's good. I think I'm in pretty good shape. In just a few minutes, we'll have the whole assembly off. The other thing I'm going to do right now is I'm going to basically disconnect the boat from the winch. I'm assuming there might be a little bit of tension on there, and I don't want the winch stand to move too much when I take it off. The other thing I forgot to do, which I'll do right now, is I need to make sure I put the winch stand in the same spot. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to get my little trusty tape measure and mark it off. So the winch stand, the back edge of the winch stand is 12 inches from the back edge of this cross member. Okay, so that way I'll have the boat balanced in the same spot. Got the winch stand released from the boat. So now once I finish removing the U-bolts, I should be able to just lift the stand off and I should be all set. Then the next step would be to take this back bolt off, and then we'll be able to slide the tongue out. So, there's one rusted U-bolt off, second one, and now that means we should be able to take off the winch stand without a problem. Here goes. Okay, so we've run into snag number one, and it's not really a big thing. I've just got to go off to the local hardware store to get a new tool. So it turns out, I should have thought of this before, but I don't have a 1-inch socket, so I can't remove the end bolt right now. And I may also go and get a breaker bar too, because I tried this with a pipe wrench a little while ago, and it's pretty tight. So I think of all the pieces that we've got so far, this is probably going to be the sticking point. So it's off to and we'll be back in a few minutes. Okay, I'm back. Local hardware store did not have sockets large enough for what I was looking for, or box end wrenches large enough. I was going to a chain store, you know, one of the national hardware chains, and they didn't have the parts, the tools I needed in stock. So I wound up at an auto parts store, which is, I thought, a good thing to keep in mind, because I don't normally think of auto parts stores as places I'd go to buy tools. But in this case, they had both the 15/16 socket, as well as the box end wrenches. And the other thing, which is actually fairly rare, is this guy. This is a 55 Torx bit, which I'm going to need in order to tighten some of the shoulder bolts that are I need to put on the sockets, to put on the swing away hinge fitting. So anyway, I got the parts. I'm going to go ahead and get started. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just do the normal thing. Since this is a through bolt, as soon as this breaks loose, I'm going to have to need another wrench in order to keep it from spinning. So I'm going to go ahead and put that on here. Let's see. This is a little bit tight, so I'm going to go ahead and put a, I've got a piece of a pipe on here. Give me a little bit more longer lever arm. Okay, so it's at least moving. I'm gonna move this out a little bit, get a little more lever arm on it. There you go. So I think this is good, this will work. And I think pretty soon I'll be able to put the normal ratchet on this instead of the breaker bar. It's getting fairly loose now. Let me just try the bar by itself. Oh yeah, check this out. So you probably can't see this, but that's a little nylock nut in there, okay? So we're done. All right, well, we'll see. Let me go ahead and tap this out. Probably not a good thing to do with a wrench. Let me go get a hammer. Okay, Mr. Sledge will take care of this. Yep, there we go. There we go. So got that guy out. Let's get that. Make sure these pieces, we don't lose these pieces. And let's see if it works. Oh yeah, look at that. Okay, so it's looking good. So I'm gonna go ahead and pull this guy out now. And you can see it's pretty much a piece of cake right out through the channel. Here's basically the receiver. You can see that, came right out. So that's good. So now we've got the replacement tongue, or at least the back half of it. You can see we've got the piece that's drilled with the four holes, already pre-drilled for the bolts. That's a good thing. You know, I don't know if you've had much experience like drilling through these kinds of materials, but it's just sort of a pain in the neck with the normal, you know, homeowner type of tools and not non-industrial grade stuff. So this is actually quite a benefit. So that slid right in. Holes are positioned perfectly. Bolt will go through here. This will be where the chain attachments are, and I think we're just about set. So I'll put in the bolts, and then we'll get ready to put in the coupling. Okay, so I've got the bolt in, got the torque wrench on. I've got it set at 100 foot-pound or pound-feet of torque, and once we get that tightened up, then it's on to the next step, which is to put on the coupler. So far, everything's been going pretty smoothly on the transition, but now we finally run into something that's going to be take a little bit of extra work to get around. Our trailer is a year 2000 trailer. The tongue was supplied to us here in 2009, and you can see we've got a little bit of an issue now. This bolt hole, which is at the front of the frame and basically helps hold the tongue in place, doesn't quite match the hole that was in the tongue as supplied by the manufacturer. So we've got to figure out what we're going to do. We're going to have to either grind. We're going to have to grind one of the two in order to get everything to work. I'm thinking we'll probably grind the inner tongue hole back and make it large enough to take the second bolt. The only reason this is an issue is because we're going to use the second hole to basically use the cross bolt that will hold the safety chains in place. So it doesn't have to actually be that tight a fit, but it would be a good idea to have a pin that's the right size going through in order to get the right amount of strength in there for the push and pull forces that are going to be working on the trailer. So what we're going to do is I'm going to get a marking pin. I'm going to come in here and basically use it to mark the areas that I'm going to need to clear out on both sides. It only looks like about maybe a 16th to an 8th of an inch of material that I'll have to grind in order to get it to work. And then we'll be able to put the bolt in there, okay? Bummer. Yeah, it's a bummer partially because that means we have to take the bolt out and pull the tongue out again too, just after we bolted it in. Probably should have fitted it and checked for this before we actually bolted everything together, but you know, that's 20/20 hindsight. So like I said, on most of these types of home projects, there's always something that goes a little bit tweaky. Especially for these things that are where you're trying to match new parts with old parts and that sort of thing. So I mentioned a second ago, the problem we have now is this particular hole is about, it looks like maybe 3/32 of an inch too far forward. So I can't put the full size bolt through the cross member to hold it in place. What I'm going to do now is I've got my trusty handheld drill and a metal grinding wheel. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go basically take the hole back about that distance, because I need to be able to get the bolt in there to hold the chains and the cross member in place. Okay, so here we go. Oh, sorry, got to go get my safety glasses. Very important. Okay, so let's give it a try. After about an hour of grinding and polishing and cutting and all that sort of junk, we've expanded the holes just enough, we think, to be able to get this thing to fit. So let's get the final test here. There's the back bolt in place. We got a 4.5 inch, half inch bolt for the front. Nice. Okay, so we're in place now. Now we can do, hopefully, we can do the rest of the installation without incident. Okay, so we finally got through the safety chain issue. Now we're going to start bolting in the casting for the front coupler. So you'll notice they've got four bolts. Basically, it's pretty straightforward, it looks like. Just wind up with lock nuts and these 55, size 55 Torx. I've never seen Torx this big before in my life, but that's what they give you in the kit. So we'll just get those straightened up. These are lock nuts and they have to be torqued down to 75 pounds. So what we'll do is, now that I think about it some more, I think what we'll do is we'll start with the back and just work our way forward. I'll get rid of this one in the front because I won't be able to get a wrench on it, on the back one. Let's do that first. Okay, so now we got the chains, got the casting in place. What's next? We got to put on the front piece, and then move the coupler from the old tongue onto the new tongue. And that should be about it. So we'll take a break right now. Let's go check to see how the whether or not the garage door continues to close. Let's do that first. Okay. Let's get everything inside. And now we're gonna move. Okay, let's take a look. Oh, look at that. How's that for a tight fit? just basically touches the door. So it's a close fit, but it made it. Good one. Nice. Okay, before we go too much farther, let's go take a quick check of the hinge. So this is the male piece. This is the female piece. It's basically going to go like this. Okay, we've got a lock nut down here in the bottom. Hold that in place. And then basically, just got this puppy like this. You can sort of see the concept. But now we got a pretty hefty duty casting in here that's gonna take the load, trailering. And we just have the other tongue that we need to fit in here, which goes like this. And then whenever we want to go anyplace, or whenever we want to store the boat away, it's basically this kind of maneuver. And then swing that back. And that's about it. So this is a class 3 hitch, 3,500 pounds. They make a 5,000 pound version as well. The actual load depends on how long a tongue you put. This one's got, I bought a 36 inch tongue for this. So that's the maximum length you can get and still retain the full class 3 rating. So I think we're in good shape. We just gotta, like I said, take the coupler and the braking system off the old tongue and put it on the new tongue, and we should be done. Almost there. So now we're back to taking the coupler off. I got the small breaker bar on it. I think we're okay. That loosened up fairly easily. Okay, we're almost there. I'm gonna go ahead and put the next pieces on. Here you can see it. The final result. Went ahead and got everything all torqued down. Now what we're going to do is we're going to match it up to the male side of the casting. And basically we've already put a little color crease in here. Basically put the pin in, and instructions say to torque it down to 50 pounds. So that's what we're going to do. There we go, 50 pounds. A little bit stiff, but definitely workable. And now let's check out the pin. There we go, nice. So this is basically how it works, right? This is the towing position. You can see it's pretty solid. Don't mind the banging back there. There's just some stuff rattling around in the boat. But overall, it looks pretty solid. And then here's the best part, of course. Once we pull out the pin, presto change-o, we'll be able to swing the tongue back like this and still get the garage door closed. So that's what it's all about. Now I just got to put the coupler back on and we should be all set. Then we'll just have to rig up the safety chains, do the wiring, and put the jack stand back on. In fact, I may do that right now, but you don't need to see that. Overall, it looks good. I'll show you the end result when we're done.
So I've spared you the details of having to clamp everything back together and bolt all the different pieces together. You can see I'm pretty much done now. I've got the tongue in place. My Electrostar controller has been relocated to the tongue and plugged in. I've got the safety chains installed, the winch stand is back up, and trailer jacks installed. In a second, I'm going to back up and show you some of the things we had to do to get things put together. Things that didn't quite fit in exactly into how the manufacturer planned them to be installed.
Let's start by making doing a quick review of the final setup. So if I go from front to back, you can see the ball coupler. You can see the safety chains that are running up underneath the tongue, crossing under the tongue. We've got the Electrostar brake controller bolted to the tongue as well. As you move towards the back, you can see that the safety chains are so long that we had to zip tie them up to the bottom of the tongue, otherwise they'd be dragging on the ground. You can also see that we've had to move the anchor point for the safety chains all the way onto the main part of the frame and lower the hole from where we originally thought the position was going to be. And we'll talk about that in just a second. Normally the wiring for this kind of a trailer tongue setup would go through the middle of the tongue and then out into the frame, but the mass of wires that you need in order to hook up the electric brake controllers were big enough so that they wouldn't fit through the holes that are drilled into the frame, into the tongue, so we wound up strapping them to the outside after covering them with some corrugated plastic tubing to dress things up a bit. It turns out that attaching the safety chain was the biggest problem we had during the installation. As you can see, this final position of the safety chain is now further back on the trailer frame, and it's no longer in the middle of the frame member, but down towards the lower edge. And that's because in order to cinch the safety chain tight against the frame, that final link has to be able to lay flat. If the hole for the bolt were up in the middle of the frame member, the next to the last link, since it sits at a 90 degree angle to the first to the last link, would keep us from being able to cinch down the bolt tightly. So we decided to move the hole from the middle of a frame member down to the bottom edge, but in order to do that we had to find a place in the trailer chassis that was thin enough that we could drill through it easily without causing problems, and it turned out to be that we had to move it back about another foot or so onto the main part of the trailer frame.
As you can see, pretty solid. I think it ought to work out real well. This tongue is actually a little bit shorter than the original one. The original tongue was 42 inches measured from here to the front of the tongue. This one is 36 inches, so I'm losing about 6 inches, but I don't think that's going to make much of a difference. Other than that, I think overall it was not too bad an install. Having the holes pre-drilled from the manufacturer helped quite a bit. And the only real snag that we ran into was trying to figure out where to anchor the safety chains. Everything else pretty much fell into place, even though this is several days later. Part of that was just because we ran out of time with filming. You know, everything seems to take a lot longer when you film. So I'd say realistically, this was probably about an 8-hour job, maybe 10-hour job. Including rearranging all the wiring and doing the chains and things like that again. So not too bad a project, and now I've got an easy way to get the trailer tongue back in and get going in the mornings without having to lift a 45-pound piece of iron around at 4 a.m.